I'm an entertainer.
For me, 1977 seems like a long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away. I was locked in battle with an evil empire whose ultimate weapon, the Death Star, was trained on my home planet, threatening total annihilation at any moment. And that was just during the day. But 1977 here on Earth, you know, it really wasn't that different. It was also the year of the Empire, the British Empire. There were loyal protectors of the realm, and a band of rebels bent on bringing down the establishment, and a handsome young hero to save the day. But we begin our story of 1977 in outer space, where man made perhaps his greatest discovery of the decade.
What exactly is space dust? Well, largely cometary debris. A comet, after all, is really a dirty ice ball, and when that's heated, it begins to evaporate and throws off dust and, of course, gas also.
I've always believed that it actually does come from outer space, this stuff, and I don't know how they got it into packets, really. I suppose they must have had some kind of big funnel that went round the atmosphere or the stratosphere.
But in the 70s, a sample of this were collected.
Wait a minute.
If it floats around in outer space, how can you be sure that it's not going to harm you? But we all took that risk.
Orange! Fantastic, sports fans. I can see it from here. It's orange. Where did I put my visor up?
Could you eat space dust? Well, I suppose you could without eating dirt. I would recommend it most times, though.
I mean, I don't remember the first time I tried space dust, but I remember why you liked it. The reason why you liked it is because it exploded in your mouth. You know, you put something in your mouth and it was like lots of little tiny hopping frogs hitting the top of your, you know, hitting the roof of your mouth. It was brilliant.
He was to put loads of spacers in that and they go right at the other kids' ears. I go, listen, listen. It's pouring stuff on your tongue. It's cracking. Can you hear it?
One can of Coke, two packets of space dust, and your head would blow off.
Space dust in your mouth and a mouthful of Coca-Cola, your head would blow off.
Don't laugh, it's true.
The police say it's terrible, it's highly addictive. I was thinking, yeah, I've had loads of it. Let me tell you,
it's always our news agent took the lead and took space dust off the shelf.
There should have been a warning about more than 25 packs in a day, but I just saw it as an experiment. I've had pack after pack after pack. And all I got was that lovely kind of
lethal
in my mouth and diarrhea.
Where was the entertainment in that?
Greetings, I am Tharg. I bring you a galactic new comic, 2000 AD, with adventures from the future, including the new invincible Dan Dare. Also a genuine Thargian space spinner, free. Get 2000 AD now.
The world went disco crazy in the 70s. And in 1977, one film, one man, and one dance move became its enduring image. Get to the back of the queue, girls. It's John Travolta in Saturday Night Fever. Well, you can tell by the way I use my
walk, I'm a woman's man. No time to talk. When John first came in, we were at a dance school in Beverly Hills. He comes in, he says, well, I already know how to dance. I said, okay, go ahead, John. We can crash, we'll understand, and you
What are you doing?
His little butt crack was sticking out of his pants, you know, and he was walking around like this. And so I let him go for about a minute, and I said, okay, John, now sit down. So I started dancing for him. I did a couple Russian leaps. I did the knee drops. I started doing the point and locking up. And he just froze. He goes, that's it. This is what I want to learn.
The first X film I ever saw, I was 13 and I went with my mum. Naughty mum.
Do you think I'm losing my hair?
But John had the classic look, too. He had the blue eyes, the dark hair. You know, he had the whole thing going for him.
John Travolta was fantastically cool, I think, particularly for a 13-year-old girl living near Watford.
Hairy chest, massive medallion. Big, silky, cheap, sort of flowery open shirt, and just real nut-crushing, high-waisted trousers. It was very sexy.
Shut up, will you?
He was sort of in touch with his sensitive side. There was a lot of stuff about hair.
We just washed the hair.
There was a lot of stuff about food and loving your mum. It was all very Italian-American.
No, I work on my hair a long time, and you hit it. He hits my hair.
Stupid.
Okay. All right, come on.
I'm from the village, which borders on Little Italy. And I have to say that John Travolta got the character right.
Here's a guy that had a basic job doing basic things. And in the daytime, probably nobody recognized him. But at night, if I can't have you, I don't want nobody, baby. He was the king of where he went.
That is disco. He is disco. I don't care what they say. John Travolta is disco. I'm surprised they haven't put a statue up now of a John Travolta pose.
He could never get off the dance floor. He used to wave at me, and I'd go, all right, we'd have to go and get him away from the women. They were so turned on by the way he moved that they would literally get off their out of their chairs and come over and wait in line just to dance with him.
What's the best way to get over with a lady, right? Look good, smell good, dance your best. You got it made.
Saturday Night Fever made John Travolta an icon. Girls around the world wanted a guy like Tony, and boy, did guys want to be like Tony. They wanted to look like him, dress like him, and move like him.
After the success of Saturday Night Fever, 77 was really the year for disco.
It did explode. It exploded on the scene. But I remember coming out of the cinema, desperate to get to my own club, and we would be rehearsing out to do all this dance, and it was a buzz that John Travolta had put into it all.
The music became clearly the dominant force on the planet.
We're dancing like this, we're picking up our partners, spinning around, and all of a sudden you do a little bit more than the next guy, and before long you were doing the splits on the floor. And I actually remember being in San Francisco, and I was asked to put the girl down, and would I mind leaving the club?
Hey, don't be.
Hey, Tony, my man.
You got a studio free or what?
Yeah, two is free.
And everybody was going to dance classes. I've never seen anything like it. You could find old people and young kids in these dance classes doing the electric slide and the hustle and the Latin hustle and all these steps.
People used to, that couldn't dance, learned how to dance just so they could go out on the weekends and not look dumb.
Hand on the shoulder, hand on the hip, hand on the hip. Do it again. One, two.
I like this.
Turn it over.
Hey, Tony, you know something? You're the king out there. You're great. Great dancer.
You can do as good as me if you practice.
Yeah? You gotta be a good dancer, Tony.
Sure, why not?
No.
No?
No, you're right.
in the morning sun. I feel you touch me in the pouring rain.
We all went and got white suits, like, and we all went like that.
It was never questioned, you know, an open shirt, hairy chest, and a medallion on lots of older men.
You had to be a medallion man to have any respect. If you're on the dance floor, you had to have your open shirt, you had to have your goal right down there.
That's quite a normal figure, though, in the north. You know, in Scotland, that's somebody's got an uncle like that, you know. How deep is your love? Is
your love how deep is? It was all sexual, it was showing off. It was just the peacocks and the cockerels and the farmyard. That's what the guys were doing, the women were letting us do that.
Give me $5 for that blue shirt in the window. Hold it for me.
You couldn't go on a disco floor with some raggedy shoes on because you got lights on the floor, you have lights on the ceiling, you have lights on the side of you, so you got to be a part of that bright light when it hits you. And if it hits you and you ain't looking good, then you might as well just sit back down.
When those lights are coming down and they're pulsating on the floor, you don't really look because you can't see anybody sitting down or out there, so you really lose all inhibitions. We can try to understand the New York Times up and down there. And then, of course, they started doing parodies on it, you know, and it becomes a joke after a while because it was so popular. Everything good, it all has to come to an end when it's commercialized.
It's the world-famous Bee Gees, who have sold more records than any other group called the Bee Gees in the entire history of the world. Some people have implied that your high voices, coupled with the long hair, shirt open to the navel, revealing hairy chest and medallion look, suggest that you're somewhat less than masculine, and that you...
look the other way!
Exactly. What do you say to that?
Well, you can't tell by the way I use my walk, I'm a woman's man.
Medallion Man moved out.
You see, dancing, you can't last forever. It's a short-lived kind of thing.
Literally, bang, when he was purely the 70s. Pity, because I liked him a lot.
What separates the men from the boys? Their wheels, of course. Now, roller skates were out, but boy, if you didn't have a set of wheels back in 77, you were nowhere, man. Skateboard separates a whole lot of fun. A bad man, I'm hoping in the midday sun. A cold old lobby that'll last and last. You can't fix your cards, help you go real fast. A skateboard surfer, educated from walls.
Skateboarding could have changed my life, but it didn't. It just caused me a lot of pain and a lot of bitterness.
We can remember it was a craze. It was big. Every kid had a skateboard and everyone just got into skating. Everyone wanted to surf the pavement.
The actual boards themselves, they were kind of a rubbery plastic, normally blue, with matching wheels that were very, very fast. It was very narrow, very fast, and quite dangerous.
London's biggest toy shop prepares for the skateboard invasion with skateboard prices. £85 for this one. Of course, there has to be expensive protective clothing.
My very first skateboard was called a Black Knight, and it was a wood plank that they were mass marketing and selling, but they had metal wheels. They were like old clip-on roller skating wheels, and they were the worst.
But I liked it, but then I was aware that if I went on it too much, I would get one big fat leg and one skinny one, which wouldn't have looked good in my tight pants.
Once I got used to the feel of being on a skateboard and learned to make turns, I began to enjoy myself.
You used to get Coke cans out and used to, like, weave in and out, slalom in and out of Coke cans. You used to do handstands and all little freestyle tricks. It's all your own. You're not a team player. It's all about individuality. You make a trick, it's yours. You did it. No one helped you. You did it.
Do you want to give me a push?
Yeah, okay. Okay.
Right in it. I feel like my skateboard's gone. Excuse me.
I was absolutely useless at it. You know, you had to have the most highly defined sense of balance to stay on these things, and I just didn't have it. And it was only certain boys who could do it. You know, I would try it and come a cropper.
You'd hit a pebble, and all of a sudden, what was doing 20 miles an hour, all of a sudden it's doing 0 miles an hour, except your body's now doing 20 miles an hour and getting launched off of it forward, you know, flying. All of a sudden you'd be like, whoo!
Everybody wanted to get on that bandwagon.
What do you call the turn at the other end?
It's a kick turn.
Is it? There you go. What about looping the loop?
They wanted to be seen to be down with the kids, hanging out with the kids.
I haven't done it for such a long time. I've tried it. I have got one of my own. Had I known in advance that there was skateboarding here, I would, of course, have bought a helmet and all the other protective paraphernalia. I know what you mean. It takes a lot of time to get the balance, doesn't it? I know. Oh, well, I'm as practiced.
I got quite cocky. I remember doing a quite spectacular manoeuvre down a hill, and one of my friends was at the bottom of the hill, and I sort of came to a natural halt, and I gave this look like, you do that. And I just fell flat on my face. I don't know why. I'd come to a perfect stop.
But as the kids took to the street, so the accident rate soared. Soon, the demand on local councils to provide safe areas for the sport became overwhelming.
Because kids were out there on the pavement, they were seen as a danger. And then grannies were supposedly getting knocked over on pavements because there was no skate parks.
The council in Luton came up with the idea of a disused swimming pool, and the kids skated in.
Skateboards gave teenagers the freedom of their own wheels. But freedom at what price?
Safe from the traffic, no problem to pedestrians. The only worry came from the bruises, sprains and breaks. In fact, the National Hospital bill clicked up to £6 million.
It would be great finding that hill that was just a sheer, you know, and then seeing your mate go down and then realising that it was a one-way street and there were cars only coming up.
Get it.
Being a big lad, picked up a fair bit more momentum than most. If it were a speed trial, I'd have won.
Uh-oh, what part of me is going to get hurt? It's going to be a knee, a hand, or elbows. And most often, it was definitely the knees.
World, especially for girls, to learn about makeup and hairstyling.
For a growing up girl.
And here's Kitchen Center. No batteries, no electricity, just everything needed to play cooks. It can even blend drinks.
For a growing up girl.
Kitchen Center and Girls World. Two great growing up ideas for girls from Palitoy.
You know, being a teenager in 1977 was not an easy thing. Well, hey, being a teenager at all isn't an easy thing. You've got parents, you've got teachers, you got to get a boyfriend. And asking for a date, well, you didn't. Your friend did it. But in 1977, girls got help, and boys got easy.
Blue jeans came along in 1977 when I was 10, and I was very keen on these magazines, but my parents actually wouldn't let me get them.
I mean, I was a complete junkie already by then, actually, and obviously reading Mum's Cosmo at the same time.
We just got them at school, like, and passed them around.
Every young girl needs a little help with growing up. And in 77, they were prepared to pay good pocket money for it.
They trade upon every young girl's desire to worship pop stars and wear makeup. And I think that a lot of people make a lot of money out of it.
Money-making rubbish, or are they cheerful entertainment with good ideas and helpful advice?
I used to read Blue Jeans, and I used to always run up to the shop and buy it, and they used to have these, you know, top tips for makeup and top tips, you know, for boys and how to talk to them and what you do.
Jackie's got something for everyone. A butterfly stick pin. It's free. It's fun. Wear it here. Wear it there. You can wear it anywhere. Jackie, tops for pops. True love, too. Butterfly stick pin. Free for you. Only in Jackie tomorrow.
Tell me A, B, C, or D. Am I an optimist? Am I a pessimist? Am I outgoing? Oh, yes, more about me.
Blue Jeans, and particularly Jackie, were very important magazines. What they share is that their willingness to give information to young women in a way that they hadn't been given to them before. I mean, you can laugh at them as much as you like, you know, and they are hilarious and kind of full of useless romantic nonsense in those days, but at least they're an attempt to talk to people, you know, on their own level, like.
You are very self-involved at that age. You are very anxious about the changes within you. I mean, physical changes, emotional changes. Your hormones are raging one way or the other.
Don't leave me this way. I can't survive. Can't stay alive.
What they want to know is how to be beautiful, how to be attractive, how to be the person that everybody wants to be friends with, how to be the girl that attracts boys when you feel fat and loved and spotty.
We get hundreds of problem letters every week from kids who don't know what to do about their parents or their living conditions or their lifestyle or more serious problems.
I mean, sex, it was all a bit sort of, my boyfriend wants to kiss me, I'm not ready, you know, that kind of thing, rather sweet and naive.
A girl's writing going, but I was practicing kissing on my hand and I'm not sure, and I kissed my pillow and I'm not sure how to do it. It was always the same answer, which was just like, oh, well, it doesn't really matter and it'll feel right if it feels right. I mean, basically, you can't tell somebody how to do it, can you?
They answered questions which most adults would consider to be incredibly trivial, which was, what is a French kiss, you know, and will, you know, Les out of the Bay City Rollers like me if I've got boss eyes, and, you know, how can I get rid of my acne, you know, and all these things which are incredibly difficult for teenagers to ask each other, let alone parents.
Who cares about old people?
My great memory of Jackie is the Cathy and Claire problem page, and I remember when I was about 9 or 10, even later on, my friends and I would sit around trying to make up problems to say to them, but they, because we knew nothing about sex, they were all completely stupid, like, I've had sex with a dog, what should I do when I get pregnant? And of course, naturally, they saw right through us and they were never published.
The photo stories in those kind of magazines seemed incredibly exotic because before that we had Bunty, and then you suddenly had, you know, lots of people, you know, from Leicester, acting out, you know, kind of real true life problems.
Could anything be more glamorous? I mean, now girls of that age want to be supermodels. Then we just wanted to appear in a photo love story.
It was always the same thing. He took his glasses off, and she stood there and went, he's quite good looking, isn't he? And they'd just run off and kiss. And you just stare at the picture going, wow, that's how they do it.
That was glamour.
Breaking us down when they all should let us be. We belong to you.
There's no noodle at pot. Noodle as a noodle is the food you'll love.
There's no noodle like
hot noodle. When you've tasted one, you'll want to try the rest.
It's all coming back to me now. Chicken and mushroom, there is, isn't there? There's beef and tomato, which tasted like dirt.
My favourite flavour was beef and tomato because it had the traditional sense of a Sunday lunch, do you know what I mean, combined with noodles. And so when I was living in that bedsit, you know, I could sit there and go, wouldn't it be nice if all my family were around here now to enjoy this with me? And it's sad that I got chased out of town.
Pot noodles, I felt like an astronaut having pot noodles, because it was like, this is it, this is the future.
In the future, we'll all wear silver suits with, you know, diagonal zips and be eating stuff like pot noodles. You know, you just add boiling water and it transforms into a nutritious meal.
In an instant, effectively.
There must be a moment in your day when you'd welcome a heart-filling snack.
The product was first launched in 1977.
Hot noodle!
It went ballistic.
The one and only pot noodle.
The rest is history.
For those hungry moments in your day.
It was a genuine first for the UK market and for the food industry.
Something different, something really tasty. So here it is. New pot noodle.
People didn't know how to use it, what it was there for, what to do with it, and they had to be educated.
And all you need to make pot noodle is a kettle. Then, eat hot from the pot.
There's a line on the pot noodle, isn't there? And you should be really careful like that and make sure it didn't go above, because that might ruin the taste.
If you filled it right up, you could also get 3 rounds of bread folded, dunked in. Do you know what I mean? For you, that was more of a... because it wasn't really a full meal. You know what I mean? It was more like a starter, a fancy starter.
Pots of flavour. Mmm. Pots of warmth. Mmm. Pots of taste.
Mmm. It's essential that you let this pot noodle stew in its own juices for about 20 minutes to get the maximum effect. Let's let the monosodium glutamate go throughout and completely unclag the noodles.
Don't fuss, Mum. You know what I like?
Tender pasta noodles with vegetables and soya pieces in a rich, savoury sauce.
Now mind your shirt, Gerald.
It's not really a traditional thing you go back to your mum's for, is it? It's, oh, no one makes a pot noodle like my old mum.
Hungry!
Kettle?
Right.
I'd have quite liked it if I'd been given a pot noodle and I'd gone on to my mum. It was all pies when I was a boy.
It was seen as the food of dropouts. Do you know what I mean? In a shop, if someone had come in and bought a load of pot noodles, the women in the shop would go, watch him, he's probably a burglar, or he hasn't got a job.
Blooming tight is out here, Sarge. Put the kettle on.
I've been charged £15 for thin starters in, you know, in restaurants. Not anything like the taste sensation of the pot noodles.
Basically, absolute crap.
Golden Wonder pot noodle and pot rice.
It's a real success story for Britain.
It's a classic food for drunks, really. And just when I was reaching that point in my life when only alcohol made sense.
There's no noodle like a pot noodle, as a noodle is the food you love the best.
Pot noodles probably kept me alive. I owe them a lot more. I shouldn't slag them off, you know what I mean? Because they were my only friend for a while.
Pot noodle!
Imagine a world without Wallace and Gromit, without Creature Comforts, without Chicken Run. Well, they owe it all to this little guy. They owe it all to Morph. Morph was born in the children's TV series Take Heart. It was a show where Tony Hart got to do all the things you weren't allowed to do in art lessons at school, basically throwing paint around.
Take Heart. With Tony Hart.
Hello. Just mixing up some paint.
Lovely man, though, but I think you're off his head. Because he talked to Morph. You know, a bit of plasticine.
Come on.
Really?
Oh, dear.
And then he had that loser, Mr. Bennett, running around.
You can lend me a hand off to the gallery.
Lend you one now, if you like, Mr.
Hart.
It got him in the way, I think.
And I thought it'd come in handy.
You know, I just wanted to see him draw, really.
Think I'll try a pastel drawing now. Just get it ready.
I was left to my own resources to discover different ways of interesting, amazing sometimes.
And now, something messy.
And certainly surprising our viewers.
You do them drawings and they always show it upside down. And he'd do like a moon, and then he'd do like, and then you'd go on for it. Well, what is it? What is it? Is it a kangaroo? And then it'd turn upside down, and he'd frame it. And it'd be the moonlight on some dustbins.
Now it's time to have a look at your paintings. It's time for the gallery.
Everyone remembers the gallery. I remember it had the theme from The Deer Hunter. Doom.
Gavin has made a tissue paper one-legged duck.
The gallery became very, very popular.
Sophie sent this picture in. And you can see she's created a beach effect. By using sand. And then you'd never got them back. So we never sent anything in. Because he said we can't return your pictures. And I think, what's that on that really, Tony, is it?
Not very good, is it?
You know, I'm working hard on something here and I'm sending it in and you just can't be asked sending it back.
Don't think it's quite as simple as that somehow. Here you are, Morph. This is for you.
Wacky little sod, Morph.
I said blow, not suck.
Uh-oh.
he was not just humanoid, he was human.
It's actually becomes quite difficult to keep writing for a solo character, so he started to introduce other characters. And the first character we introduced was actually a nail brush, which actually was like a dog, it was like his pet dog.
They gave him a friend Chaz, didn't they?
Very anarchic character.
It's not funny, Morph.
Up and voop, everywhere, were they? Who knows? It's all in you. We can be heroes.
Just remember. I think Tony always felt there was a danger of him being slightly usurped.
Morph, is this mess by any chance anything to do with you? Because he was so animated, his personality started to build up.
And there was definitely a rivalry between the two of them.
I don't think so, you know. There isn't time for that sort of rivalry in this world.
But I also think he then realised it was a great plus for the show, because I think a lot of people watch the show for more.
You just like get a mallet, eh? And squash them. Bye-bye! Eh? He'd be gone before you could get to him, though, because he'd drooled. Green slime in a pot that didn't do anything.
It just came in that tub and you just whacked it out in this dollop and let it run all through your fingers.
It feels nasty, but you know it's not nasty, but it just feels like you just want to go...
All boys use to terrorise the girls, because they take little bits off and flick it up like bogeys and flick it at you, and you'd know it was slime, it wasn't really bogey, but it was the most revolting thing.
The only thing you could do was sort of make fart noises by pushing your fist into it. Yes, sir.
Well, what we used to do is, like, I'd come home and just take a little bit off and run inside and go, Mum, just came out.
The task of protecting Britain's national security in 77 fell into the hands of two fearless young men. They fought fire, with whatever means necessary. They were cool, they were handsome, and they drove a Ford Capri. They're professionals.
There's only one thing I want to say about the professionals. And he'd walk out Gordon Jackson, he'd rout up his coat, and then it'd start. If you watch that, put that on.
It's a phenomena. It has a huge number of fans, most of whom probably wouldn't admit to it outside of the confines of the living room. But it people will watch it again and again and again.
Heard what the man said.
Really good. You just wanted to do roly polies all over the place. Or did you? Was it just me?
Policemen had been sort of done to death by then. George Cowley, who had been the rather unlikely head of MI5, was asked to set up this new organisation, Criminal Intelligence 5, CI5. And they had a very broad remit from the Home Office, which meant really that they could do anything they wanted.
A typical professionals episode will begin with a pre-title sequence, which has often got very little to do with the rest of the plot. You'll then get a couple of scenes of Bodie and Doyle. Cowley will then call them in.
Bodie! Doyle, hold on a moment.
And there will then be approximately 40 minutes of car chases, which end with a very big explosion.
That was great. I mean, you're talking about the 70s, and there's not many shows that have touched it, really, I don't think. It was action, it was packed, you know, lots of screeching car chases, they're really tough, and they used to wear tight jeans. I remember that.
Loved them to the point of making my own magazine, fanzine for my own enjoyment.
What a lovely thought.
I think the reason that the programme works is very much the interaction between the three central characters.
Balloon doesn't go up till 5:30, sir.
It's just five now. No, that's long enough.
Now give us a chance to check out the area.
That's because it's very much a stereotype. But I think the Bodie and Doyle characters work largely because of the way they play off each other.
Well, that's drug squad
drug
business.
Squad business.
What are you two, some kind of music hall act?
Whatever we are, you made us.
Ta-da!
I think Bodie and Doyle were meant to have a fairly abrasive relationship, which wasn't too difficult. You know, we did have a fairly abrasive relationship.
Eric Sutton, pusher, you stay with her.
Stay with her.
And the characters just evolved, you know, we just gradually pasted them on ourselves bit by bit, because there was not really very much in the writing which gave us a character to play, so we had to invent them ourselves.
Put out an APB.
He said we'd be too late. It's too late to stop it.
Got Bodie, who's a sort of bonehead character.
You won't get any argument from me.
Very much a sort of 70s hard man.
And Bodie always spoke like that, sir. Yes, sir. Doyle, sir.
It was the coffee, you know, the coffee machine.
Fucking down all the time when they talk like that.
You've got Martin Shaw, who's the Kevin Keegan with a liberal attitude.
Doyle was always played the sort of more gentleman, like, for goodness sake, Bodie.
Thank you.
And then you've got Cowley, who's a sort of very much a throwback to British films of the 1950s, the sort of barking sergeant major type character.
So get over there, fast!
The professionals were suave and sophisticated, but the nation was divided over them. Which one was better looking?
If you liked the professionals, you had to like one or the other.
I was totally in love with Lewis Collins.
I have got a secret to tell you. You are her favourite. She told
me
that.
Oh, that's it, then I'm off. Right.
Sorry,
I hope you'll both be very happy.
Yes?
That was my idea of a dark, swarthy-looking, hunky bloke, and he was so cool.
Right, credit card opened so many doors.
Oh, God, this is so embarrassing.
In 1977, the Empire was strong. Elizabeth II's reign had lasted 25 great years, and to mark this occasion, there was to be an enormous celebration the length and breadth of the country. For Queen and for country, and a day off from school, which is really the main thing, right? The Jubilee was a memorable day and had to be commemorated in the traditional way, which meant buying a plate, or at least a mug.
I've got quite a collection of 1977 Silver Jubilee memorabilia, and it's all been kept out of a tongue-in-cheek and collected through a kind of a subversive way.
I know I've got a lovely plate from 1977.
The stupid little flags.
Perfect condition.
The images of the Queen that were allowed to be printed are just absolutely hilarious, and the mugs and everything around it was just brilliant.
I've got in the region, I suppose, of about 250 mugs, not all different, some of them are sets.
You just don't realise how dated 1977, the Queen's Silver Jubilee, and the way we celebrate it looked. It's very, very funny.
In actual fact, very charming.
It was so banal.
In 1977, there wasn't the cynicism that was going to come in 10 years later, so there was great warmth and love, and that's my abiding memory of it. And, of course, this incredible figure in this shocking pink.
I was one of the senior footmen at the palace at that time.
As we left the palace, the Queen came round and she looked at us and she said, the boys can't walk all the way to St Paul's with those pumps on, which we were very grateful for because they were very uncomfortable. And she said, get slip-ons. But now there's the horses, and there's horse muck comes onto the road that we were supposed to walk through this. A lot of us didn't want to, basically, with the tights and everything we had on, in case perhaps we skidded or something.
I was a girl guide, a patrol leader, so took all that military sort of thing quite seriously, really excited about carrying the flag.
The children went in fancy dress, that sort of thing, red, white and blue, totem poles, whatever they were. The parties, the dressings up, that brought everyone together. And I think anything that brings people together must be good. It must be.
These children are going to have a very good party.
Maybe the schools were let out early to have a party.
He did get a day off school, yeah.
It meant a lot to the children, I feel, and the youngsters, because it was special.
I was a pike in 1977, so obviously would have nothing to do with anything like the Queen's Jubilee. And even though I hated school, I remember trudging resolutely and hanging out by the gates and getting my caretaker to let me in so I could go to school on that day, because I didn't want to be allowed to go home and watch it on TV, which I thought was disgusting.
In 1977 in Britain, a band of rebels, disillusioned with the establishment, burst onto the music scene. Their weapons were a song and a safety pin and a God Save the Queen. They were the Sex Pistols. God Save the Queen! The fascist
regime! It made you a moron! God Save the Queen, you know, the fascist regime and all that. It upset so many people.
Extreme distaste. She ain't no human
being. I do remember being quite sort of shocked, but then thinking, hey, what the hell?
You bought it then to say that you were challenging the system, and your parents hated it and your grandparents hated it.
Yeah, I think it's just trash, man. There's no future, no future, no
future for you. It was an alternative national anthem, you know, it's a symbolic attack on ways of controlling the way people think about themselves and their place in the world.
God Save the Queen, the fascist regime, she made you a moron.
Yes, the Queen would be concerned.
Because it wasn't a personal attack on her personally, it was what she represents.
No, I think it should have been banned, quite honestly.
Banned?
Yeah, I'm sure I could have banned it.
One week after EMI dumped the Sex Pistols, A&M Records picked them up and staged a contract signing ceremony in front of Buckingham Palace.
And to sign outside Buckingham Palace showed very clearly that there was barbarians at the gates ready to knock them down. Someone thought it would be wonderful to go on a news program.
No, no. What was the rude word?
Shit. It was live.
Go on, you've got another 5 seconds. Say something outrageous.
You dirty bastard.
Go on, again.
That man who talked like that, and he was absolutely outraged, and you just think, oh, God, thank God for punk, because it changed something.
I'll be seeing you soon. I hope I'm not seeing you again. I am a
I adored the fact that they were so bad.
What did you think of them?
Crap. By being bad, I thought they were good.
Brilliant.
What did you like about them?
Everything. The way they dress, the way they just, the way they sing, everything.
Well, I think seeing the Pistols was like stepping on a landmine. You know, it just blew up your whole worldview. The audience was this angry beast that Rotten was winding up, and the look and the theatre of the whole thing was electric.
think with Cyrus, it struck a chord, you know, and we became the standard bearers for that whole generation of people.
Over the last 12 months, punk rock has become almost a battle cry in British society. For many people, it's a bigger threat to our way of life than Russian communism or hyperinflation.
Degrading and disgusting for our children to hear and see such things.
I'm good looking and I have a good figure and girls like me.
Well, it's lowering the standard of our people in Gaffilly.
I have never seen or heard the Sex Pistols, and frankly, I'm rather glad I didn't, because after all pop groups sound to me rather like tomcats being put through a mincer.
It frightened people, it frightened the police, it frightened old people, it frightened the state, really, and it rocked, you know, it rocked British society.
I think it was the last time when you were brought up at school believing in the kind of residue of empire. By the mid-70s, I think people like the Sex Pistols coming out of schools, whenever they did, realised that there was basically just a slag heap waiting for them.
I wanted to do something for me, because look at me now, I'm nothing.
I don't have any heroes. They're all useless.
Sex Pistols' current record, God Save the Queen, is at number one in the Capitol Hit Parade today.
There was no number one that week.
It's like their knighthood, really, that. You know, that's better than a knighthood, isn't it? You can't have number one because the Sex Pistols are number one, so number one has to go this week.
God Save the Queen was the number one single in Jubilee Week. Banned from playing it anywhere, the Sex Pistols took to the River Thames on Jubilee Day itself.
I get the feeling you've been trapped.
Banned on the land, we decided to play our tribute to the Queen from the river. Between the hours of 6 and 8 p.m., the Sex Pistols played their songs beneath the bridges of London.
God save the Queen! Fascist regime, it made you a moron. Potential hate bomb.
We never set out to shock, we just set out to tell the story as we see it, speak our minds, be blunt, be full for it.
River police encircled us, and no matter how many Newcastle brown ale bottles were thrown over the side, we were eventually drawn back.
They arrested Malcolm! They arrested Malcolm!
And I and others were arrested.
We mean it, man!
And that was history.
In England's dreaming.
I'm the robot king from Planet Zar. I'll beam away your Milky Bars.
Oh, no, you won't.
Uh-uh.
It's the Milky Bar King!
Being in Star Wars changed my life. It made Princess Leia famous, and I just happened to look like her. It made me into an action figure, a Pez dispenser, a shampoo bottle, and a soap. And no matter where I go or what I accomplish in this life, it will say on my gravestone, here lies Princess Leia Organa and her incredibly weird hairstyle.
Chewie, get us out of here!
It's here! It's that movie!
Star Wars was massive.
The most obsessive thing that I'd ever got into.
I have you now.
Wow.
Into the box, fly boy.
Unbelievable.
The
There'd been a whole generation, maybe two generations, of children growing up without this kind of swashbuckling action adventure.
Good luck.
We knew that the science fiction fans would all turn out, because they knew about it, and they were going to come the first week, because that's when they wanted to see it. It was only after the first week, and the lines kept coming, that we realized that we might be onto something.
The attendance at Star Wars has been almost astronomic. Queues are still forming. In America, more money was taken at box offices in 1 week than for the prestigious Jaws.
People wanted clear-cut heroes and clear-cut villains and a clear-cut morality. So you have, you know, almost a sort of stripped-down comic strip kind of plot.
I'd wanted to be a priest, but I liked fighting. And this combined the two, because you had the spirituality, but you got to cut blokes' arms off, didn't you, with lightsabers?
Sort of a fairy tale. There's a princess, and there's the wise man, and there's the rogue, and there's the hero.
Everybody has that Leia fantasy.
I recognised your foul stench when I was brought on board.
Beautiful Harrison Ford.
My dead body.
We just talked about Luke Skywalker.
There's a very bad feeling about this.
For a lot of these people, it was like living through the whole experience. It was sitting through 2 hours and actually living through the adventure, and they wanted to do it again.
I've come to see Luke Skywalker.
I don't want anybody to see a film 314 times.
You watch the movie a few more times, you start going, oh, Han Solo. Han Solo's cool.
Han Solo, and he's my favourite goodie.
When you start growing up, when you grow up, you start going, oh no, Darth Vader's the cool, oh, Stormtroopers.
Now I am the master.
Only a master of evil, Darth.
All of that energy was there in the archetypal sense of a classic myth.
Will somebody get this big walking carpet out of my way?
No reward is worth this.
The prestige of being able to say you've seen Star Wars is something akin to royalty, really.
We like this bit, that bit, the arm being chopped off.
The man chopped off the person's arm. Fantastic.
The most self-contained, brilliant movie that anyone could ever expect.
It's a good film, but get a life.
Oh my, I'd forgotten how much I hate space travel.
In Britain alone, 30 different manufacturers have cashed in with a galaxy of goodies.
Merchandising became a huge profit center, and it was really the first time that it had ever been done on that scale. Everybody was sort of astonished by it.
You could buy Star Wars anything. There was nothing you couldn't buy.